numerous ethics, so it's very hard. So what struck me the most about this exhibition of Antonio Guerrero is the fact that a non-artist in an environment of privation, the environment of prison cell, okay, an environment that unfortunately has become more prevalent to so many people of color today, to the African American community, to the Latinos in this country, it has become very commonplace, and this is one of the saddest, if not the saddest, reality of our democracy right now here. So what is remarkable about these pictures is that if it's hard for an artist to produce art in the regular daily life, right, just to figure out how to do it, how hard must it have been for somebody in prison, like Guerrero, to come up with these things? And what this speaks to is the power of art, the remarkable transformative power of putting in paper or in stone or whatever it is you have available, putting those feelings, those emotions, those reaffirmation of your, the reaffirmation of your senses, and especially the need to communicate, to reach out and tell the other, listen, this is how I'm feeling, this is how I look at it, this is what I treasure. And ultimately, those feelings, even if they're so useless, become pretty much the building blocks of our history. Those are the things we consult, those are the things we go for, those are the things we study after everything is said and done and we disappear. So in that regard, I find this to be an extraordinary exhibit because it reflects opulence in the midst of the scarcity of sensorial stimulus that is a jail. I don't think we need to talk, in my intervention, I don't want to talk about the political significance, of course, of the Cuban Five. We've heard a little bit of that already, and I'm sure we'll hear some more. But all I want to say is that we hope to keep combining Puerto Rico with so many things, especially with the close island of Cuba. Come November, we're going to have our yearly festival called Corimix. We're devoting it to Cuba this year, to the mixture of Cuba and Puerto Rico.
Our next speaker, and so he's a leader of the May 30th coalition to free Oscar Lopez. Puerto Rican independent fighter was political. He was prisoner for nearly 34 years. And I should also note that Fernando Gonzalez and along with Oscar Lopez, they've been together in prison in Oxford. This concept of fighting, so that there's actually new each other. One of the paintings here, it's right towards my left, is actually the portrait of Fernando Gonzalez and his wife, Rosa Aurora, which was painted by Oscar in prison. So, if you get a chance, we're going to take a look at that. Our next speaker right now is Alejandro Molina.
Thank you for the invitation to speak here. I'll be brief, but it's a pleasure and a privilege to speak at a gathering like this where Oscar would be present if he were on. I say that because in the midst of organizing the May 30th rally and march for Oscar Lopez Rivera, a march which we hope to mobilize over 5,000 people to, that will begin in Harlem and end up in an environment with a rally that over 40 groups, civic, community, political, as well as 20 elected officials have endorsed. It is important to not lose the foundational and historical setting that is so present here when we talk about Puerto Rico, the colonial status of Puerto Rico, and the resistance to that colonial status that Oscar Lopez Rivera and so many like him embodied. The campaign to free Oscar is born with the intervention, with the military occupation of Puerto Rico on July 25th, 1898, by General Nelson A. Miles, with 16,000 US soldiers. in the port city of Guanica, Puerto Rico. It's significant because Oscar himself, born in 1943, immigrates to the U.S., to Chicago when he's 14. He's actually brought by his older sister. And that's when he starts realizing that the U.S. is a very racist place. He's very
acclimating, but yet he goes on, he enjoys school, he graduates, and he's drafted. He tells me, and I've had the privilege of visiting him for the past 25 years, that before he went into prison, before he went to Vietnam, he said, I like to dance. I was a good dancer. I like to dress up. I had a business. He had a Texaco gas station. He goes, I just enjoyed being alive. He was young. He was 25, 26 years old. Those 14 months, at the end of which he came home with a Bronze Star being decorated for valor in the face of enemy action, were transformational to his consciousness because he returned completely committed to changing the situation of Puerto Ricans in the U.S. and relating that to Puerto Rico, to the colonial status of Puerto Rico. I say that because there is no being indicted, being arrested on May 29, 1981. He is on the verge of serving, of beginning the service of his 34th year in federal custody. We tell you now, after 34 years, after the successful release of the five nationalists in 1979 by President Jimmy Carter, of the 11 Puerto Rican freedom fighters in 1999 by President William J. Clinton, that there is no valid legal or ethical, political or moral reason for the continued incarceration of Oscar Lopez Rivera. Here is a man who holds his head high, who tells people, I sleep well at night. In a recent interview in Univision, in the New Jersey station Univision, he said something, this is in Spanish, and it just came out less than a month ago. He said, bueno, cuando I, they asked him, how are you doing, serving 33 years? He goes, bueno, cuando, hay cuando se tiene que pagar un precio por la libertad, se paga y es todo. Right, very humble declaration. When there is a price to pay for freedom, you pay it, and that's it. How many times have we heard freedom fighters like Malcolm X talk about the price for freedom? How many times have we struggled to make sure, not only in the protection and the defense of the health and conditions of our freedom fighters in jail, but the ultimate goal to have them get out to rejoin the struggle for freedom. And so I end, and I promised I'd be short, with an invitation to all sectors, to everyone, to join us on Saturday, May 30th, here in New York City, in Harlem, on 125th and Adam Clayton Powell Jr., to march and rally to free Oscar Lopez Rivera. Thank you, and viva Puerto Rico Libre.
Gracias, Alejandro. Our next speaker, who is actually based in Jersey City, a well-known artist who has organized various trips to Cuba for decades, is Ben Jones, who says Cuba is his second home. Ben Jones.
Good evening, everybody. I'm glad to be here tonight and just laughing to myself. I said, you need to go to a black church, because as I hear all the speakers and as I think of the black ministers, one of the main things they do is the collection and the offering is real important. So you got to fire people up. So I'm going to try to fire you up a little bit so you get the hallelujah spirit. How many of you have been to Cuba? Okay. And how many of you plan to go to Cuba? Okay, good. I always say to people, Cuba's like Nina Simone. If you ever had the experience to see her in person, she's an experience that you could never forget, and that's what Cuba's like. Once you experience Cuba, you'll never forget it. It's such a unique country. I started going there in 1977. And when I went there and saw so many black people like me living there that you don't usually see in the newspapers and of Cuban people here, it just excited me to keep returning. And so I've been there about 65 times. I can't get enough of the place. But I'd like to start out with a couple of quotes that that I read tonight that Antonio Guerrero said. And this first one deals with the trial that they had to deal with in Miami. And Antonio Guerrero says, the harsh sentences had only one purpose, and that purpose was to punish Cuba. But Cuba still has the victory, because those Cuban five have returned back to Cuba, and they're still doing revolutionary work. The second quote that I have is that he says, you can't silence the truth of our honorable revolutionary country. You have a lot of countries, but how many countries are revolutionary? The other thing is this last quote, it's for us. It says, no battle waged against revolutionary ends with something you did. No, you have to live from what you do each day. And that's why I'd love to salute the two mothers who are here tonight who've lost their sons, because you teach me what revolution is. And I'm just so grateful to you. And I hope one day you two get to Cuba so Cuba could see real revolutionary women in this country too. That was that. The other thing is, I want to, being an artist, what's the importance of the artist? And I once heard this statement that said, the role of the artist, an artist should be a thinker. An artist should create consciousness. And that a thinker should penetrate the veil of reality. We know we live in a commodified or corporate controlled society. And the purpose of the artist, or the purpose of a thinker, is to get us to truth. And this is what artists tend to do. And I was going to talk later about the form of Antonio's work. The importance, I have all these degrees that you get in school and stuff like that, but there's nothing like a self-taught artist. Because a self-taught artist will put things in their art that maybe some of the people who are exhibiting in slick galleries or gone to schools don't put in their art. They'll take chances, they'll do things to really help us to penetrate the veil. So as I think of this self-taught artist who was in prison, and a prison in this country is more about punishment than it is about rehabilitation. And even in this prison, he still did art, as somebody mentioned. Today, I'm such a Cuba fanatic that I've been watching television all day trying to see what's happening with Obama and Raul Castro. And I really didn't want to come tonight, you know, but anything for Cuba you have to do. A black woman from North Carolina, she's one of the representatives from North Carolina, she was referring to a statement that Martin Luther King made. He said the most important thing in any society is that you give people health. Cuba, it's a given. She said the second most important thing is education. And then the third thing, and this is why I'm so glad the director of this center has been to Cuba, is the level of culture that you give people. In Cuba, the people really get a level of culture. It's not this commodified commercial stuff that you get here. So as I wrote down all these different things, I'm trying to see what else I have to say, is that when you go to a funeral, I always feel a funeral is for the living, it's not for the dead, because the dead is gone. So And one of the things, I'm sort of a troublemaker because I always get on him about different things, is that we know the church is here, the converted is here, but we got to get the young people here. You got to bring more young people to this, because if we don't have any young people behind us, what's going to follow us? You know. So I said my few little words, and I hope you got something from it. And thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Ben. Somebody else that we need to recognize in the audience, which I just found out right now, is Hawa Ba. Her son, too, was killed by 28. A cab driver was killed by a gunfire from three policemen in September of 2012. Our next speaker is Kathleen Paolo, representing Coalition of the Concerned Legal Professionals, which has organized 8 delegations of Cuba, which supports the normalization of U.S. and Cuba relations. Kathleen?
Good evening. I'll be very brief. My name is Kathleen Paolo. I'm the operations manager of the National Coalition of Concerned Legal Professionals. We're all volunteer. We're not government funded. We're lawyers, paralegals, students, people from all walks of life, and we are fighting for legal recourse and meaningful access to the courts for the growing number of people in the United States who cannot afford attorneys or access to our courts. In the U.S. today, you get about as much justice as you can afford. And from the time we began in 1976, we have built our organization on the premise that our efforts in the legal arena, our legal advice, our information, our advocacy, our lawsuits, these things are not enough in and of themselves to accomplish our goal. And for almost 40 years, we have always combined organizing in the community with our work in the legal arena. And one of the things we've done is we published a magazine. We've written a lot about the Cuban Five cases, to educate people all across the United States about the injustice of this case. We see that same combination of organizing and the legal arena in the victory of the release of the 5 Cuban heroes who fought against terrorism and for that paid a heavy price in the injustice of the U.S. justice system. And while the legal approach was very important, in fact, the attorney for the 5 said, okay, the attorney for the 5 said that the court's refusal to decide their habeas corpus petition, which is supposed to be a right under the United States Constitution, was almost unprecedented. And only after years of Freedom of Information Act requests was it revealed that the U.S. government had paid journalists to write articles virulently negative to the Cuban Five. And they plastered these articles across the Miami media to create an atmosphere of hysteria toward the defendants and ensure their convictions. Not everyone knows this, but this is a specific violation of U.S. law. So the courts alone were not the solution, and the release of the Cuban Five came in part as a result of organizing efforts all over the world, including the groundswell of public support organized by the July 26 Coalition, and we did want to acknowledge their hard-fought contribution toward this victory. The U.S. couldn't continue to sweep this matter under the rug because there's the pressure of the developing international trade in the region. The Caribbean now is at the crossroads of north, south, and east-west trade, the enlarged Panama Canal, the plans for a new Nicaraguan canal, the development of deep water ports all over the Caribbean, and of course the dynamic and innovative plans for Cuba's Mariela port and the development zone, some of which I saw when I was in Cuba last November. But even with the impending resumption of diplomatic relations and prospects for future economic benefit through all of this, the Cubans have never backed down on their principles. They said there is no deal. There will be no deal until we have our heroes back home. They said, give us back our heroes, and now their heroes are home. And so we're very happy about this. That's a little rich. And just to kind of sum up, the U.S. claims to be governed by a rule of law. This is what we fight for, but instead is too often governed by crisis and inspiration outside the law itself, claiming the right to extraordinary recourse. And the use of the courts to further a political agenda, whether it's a particular political agenda or the government itself projecting its foreign policy positions upon the court, should be and is a very grave concern. It distorts the United States Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Some say that our mass incarceration rate makes the U.S. a rogue nation, one that has made a decision not to follow what's normal Western, you know, democratic approach. We have 5% of the world's population, and we have 25% of the world's prisoners. And to solve these problems, take an organized approach. All of us people have to join together across the nation, and indeed across the world, approaching the problem through a variety of ways, so we can create a legal system that serves the majority of working people and not just the 1%. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Catherine. And Cuba is calling, so right now it's an honor of hearing Mita Rodriguez, Antonio's mother, and his sister, Mariuchi Guerrero. Just give us a few seconds, we should actually get them.
No me escuchan.
Sí.
Bueno, saludos desde Nueva York. Gracias por compartir este gran evento, esta gran inauguración de la arte exhibición de Antonio. Tenemos algunas preguntas, dos o tres preguntas. No sé si está interesado o para comentar preguntas después que termine tu discurso.
Sí, como quieran, como ustedes quieran. Nosotros, bueno, agradecerle a todos los amigos que están allí, a todos los amigos solidarios, por estar hoy reunidos ahí en esa actividad, por la presentación de la exposición de mi hermano, Asueltos por la Solidaridad. Creo que es el título más merecido que pueda llevar una exposición de mi hermano, porque la solidaridad jugó un papel determinante en el regreso de nuestros 5 hermanos, y le estamos agradecidos a todos, y sobre todo la solidaridad dentro de Estados Unidos.
Bueno, Mariuchi, disculpa, pero es un error. Aquí tenemos Dwayne, que va a estar traduciendo, si puede repetir otra vez, disculpa.
¿Cómo no?
Un pausa, sí. Y cuando habla, un poquito pausa dentro de algunas palabras, ¿ok?
Está muy bien, okay.
Ok, otra vez, vuelvo a repetir. Gracias, que te escuches espectacular.
Bueno, muchas gracias a todos los amigos solidarios por estar ahí reunidos hoy en la presentación de la exposición de mi hermano.
Thank you very much for being here in solidarity with my brother's paintings.
Él no puede estar aquí hoy en esta videoconferencia porque se encuentra de traslado de la provincia de Guantánamo hacia Santiago de Cuba.
And he can't be here today because he was asked to go to the province of Guantánamo and Santiago de Cuba.
Sí, lamenta mucho no ser él propiamente el que se comunique con ustedes.
We're sorry that he can't be the one to speak with you.
Pero bueno, mi mamá y yo hemos venido en su representación a agradecerles y a estar, bueno, en comunicación con ustedes que tan importantes han sido en la solidaridad durante todos estos años.
But my mother and I are here in this place. I have to thank you for the solidarity that you have extended in the United States all these years.
Estamos en la mejor disposición de responder todas las preguntas que los amigos quieran hacer.
We're very glad to answer any questions that you might have.
Y solo decirle que esas pinturas fueron inspiradas básicamente por el apoyo de la solidaridad mundial.
And those paintings were inspired by the support of the international solidarity that they received.
Y que, como ustedes pueden apreciar, reflejan los momentos vividos en el juicio.
As you can see, they reflect the moments that they lived during the trial.
y que a pesar de que fueron declarados culpables y sentenciados injustamente, ellos sintieron que habían sido absueltos por la solidaridad.
They felt that they had been absolved by solidarity.
Porque ustedes, los amigos solidarios, hicieron que el mundo conociera de esta injusticia.
Because you were the ones who let the world know about this injustice.
Y gracias a ustedes, hoy nuestros cinco hermanos ya están con nuestra familia y en su patria.
And thanks to you, our five brothers are here with their families and in their own country.
Y estamos viviendo días muy felices gracias a todos ustedes.
And we're living very happy times because of you.
Entonces, lo que ustedes quieran, pues aquí estamos a su disposición.
So, if you want to ask some questions, we're here to answer.
And if you'd like to ask some questions, feel free to come up with a mic. And if you do have any questions, please keep it brief or come to be really precise.
Okay? Okay.
Okay.
I have the first
okay.
One.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Me da mucho gusto verla, aunque no la había visto antes, pero... Y yo soy una de las mamás que perdió a sus hijos y que ahora estamos en Victoria con ustedes, porque nos dio mucha alegría que sus hijos pudieran saber, los esposos y todo, y a la mamá, que Dios me la bendiga.
Muchas gracias.
I just want to say that I'm happy that to see them, number one, and number two, that I'm glad that they reunited their families, and I'm glad that they have a victory. That's what I feel, victory.
Okay, I'm going to speak English, you know, right? Okay, tell her that I'm very happy that her son is home.
No, haciendo eso lo que hacen. No, no pueden pegar tanto.
No escuchamos. Sí, pero no importa, no se escucha. Yo puedo entender un poco, pero...
Por si entiendo un poco.
Ya me encontró un poco, ¿no? Ok,
nosotros queremos decir que estamos contentas de verla otra vez, pero también queremos estar con ustedes en Cuba, porque nosotros nos vamos a encontrar a brothers.
Bueno, aquí la esperamos con los brazos abiertos.
Chava, thank you very much.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias, un abrazo para ustedes.
This is not a heavy question. We're aware here that when they were released, they hit the ground running and started working on many fronts, doing their revolutionary work to continue carrying out the project. But we want to know, have they gone swimming yet?
We want to know.
Quieren saber, saben que cuando llegaron a Cuba empezaron a trabajar inmediatamente y a hacer discursos y pedir por toda la isla, pero quieren saber si han tenido un poco de esparcimiento y si han podido ir a nadar.
Sí, bueno, les explico. Ellos todavía no han empezado a trabajar. Las actividades que han hecho, las han hecho por voluntad propia de ellos, porque el pueblo aclama la presencia de ellos en muchos lugares.
They have not actually started proper work yet, but they are being sought after throughout Cuba. So they've been traveling to be able to speak to people and let them know what they went through.
Sí, han tenido la oportunidad de nadar un poquito, no mucho.
They haven't been able to go swimming that very much.
Bueno, de compartir con los amigos, con la familia y con muchas personas que durante todos estos años nos acompañaron en esta lucha. Y ahora nos preparamos ellos y la familia para recibir a muchos amigos que vendrán a celebrar el primero de mayo. Los esperamos a ustedes también.
Bueno, Marucci y Berta, aquí es María Alicia Waters, de la editora Pathfinder y del libro de Los Vueltos por la Solidaridad. Sí,
pero bueno, cuando...
Es María Alicia la que habla.
Sí.
Hola María Alicia, mi mamá te manda aquí un beso.
Bueno, cuando Tony habla siempre de... Tony habla siempre del papel de su arte, su trabajo artístico en la cárcel como medida de resistir y de luchar. Y quiero muchísimo si ustedes pueden hablar un poco de esto y la importancia de esto en todo lo que hacía los cinco para combatir sus condiciones y de vencer después de todos estos años. Tony always speaks, when he speaks about the importance of the art as a weapon in their hands to resist the conditions in which they were being held for all of those 16 plus years. And I asked Marucci and Mirtha if they would speak a little bit about this and the importance of this, not only for Tony, but for all of us and for prisoners everywhere.
Gracias Mariali y gracias por llevar esa exposición a los amigos en Estados Unidos. Gracias a Pathfinder también por el apoyo que nos ha brindado durante todos estos años. Le explico ahora sobre Tony del arte. Tony le gustó siempre dibujar, era ingeniero civil de profesión, pero aprendió a pintar en la prisión.
Thank you very much for bringing his paintings here. And thank you to Pathfinder Press for the work they've done. Tony used to like to draw when he was a child. He liked to make drawings with pencils and stuff like that. But he didn't really learn to paint until he was in prison.
Con otros presos que lo enseñaron y autodidacta también. La mayor parte de todo su tiempo autodidacta.
So he actually taught himself in prison. He was trained as a civil engineer.
Y creo que la pintura se convirtió en una necesidad de resistencia.
Painting became a need for him as a way to fight back and resist.
Y pienso que mi hermano utilizó la pintura para poder comunicarse con el mundo exterior.
And he used painting as a way to communicate with the outside world.
Para poder a través del arte llegar a muchos amigos en el mundo. Y que las personas pudieran comprender quiénes eran los cinco.
To be able to reach people around the world and to help them understand who they were.
Personas que ha, Tony, que ha pintado la naturaleza, las flores, las aves, ha hecho muchos retratos de mi mamá, muchos retratos de amigos solidarios.
He has painted a lot of flowers and birds, and he's also made many portraits of our mother and other people, friends and family.
A través de su arte le mostró al mundo lo que fueron los 17 meses de castigo en el hueco.
He also showed through his art what the punishment of 17 years of a whole, I'm sorry, 17 months of a whole life.
A través de su arte le mostró a los amigos lo que sucedió en el juicio, que es esa exposición que ustedes tienen ahí.
And through through the exposition that you see around you, that he was able to explain what happened during the trial as well.
Y eso fue lo que él quiso, poder a través de algún lenguaje, que fuera la pintura, que fueran los poemas, poder llegar a mucha gente para que conocieran que eran hombres de bien que solo habían tratado de defender a su pueblo de las acciones del terrorismo. Que demostrarle a las personas quiénes eran ellos a través de su arte, que eran personas buenas que estaban en los Estados Unidos defendiendo a su pueblo del terrorismo. Después se convirtió en un maestro para otros presos de lo que él había aprendido del arte de la pintura. Trataba de incentivar en los presos esta forma de ocupar el tiempo en cosas útiles. Y les cuento que mi hermano en la prisión de Mariana logró que se presentaran 3 exposiciones de pintura de los presos que estaban allí. Y pienso eso, que la pintura se convirtió en una necesidad de resistencia. Les confieso que desde que llegó a Cuba no ha tenido tiempo de volver a pintar. Pero él cree que sí, que lo va a seguir haciendo. Aunque él dice que no es un artista plástico, pero va a tratar de seguirse superando en el arte. Independientemente que quiere desarrollar su futuro en lo que se necesite, lo que la revolución necesite de él. Y en su profesión como ingeniero civil. Gracias, María Alice.
Tenemos uno o dos preguntitas, ¿está bien? O porque un caballero que quiera preguntar.
Hola, soy un joven mexicano, estamos aquí mostrando su identidad de Carlos Tinapa para los últimos años también. Y nada, solamente pues nos alegra que tenemos dentro de las madres. Y nosotros tenemos una caravana que viene de los Estados Unidos, de los padres, que estamos esperando a que se les encuentre comida.
No entiendo. Hace falta que se alejen el micrófono porque no se oye bien.
Sí, no se entiende muy bien. ¿De Pastores por la Paz?
No, ¿me escucha?
¿Se escucha?
No, no, ahora mejor, sí.
Bueno, soy un joven mexicano, estoy trabajando con la caravana 43 de los padres de Sinapa.
Un poquito más, acércate un poquito más el micrófono.
¿Ahí me escucha?
Ahí.
Yo soy un joven mexicano.
Dime.
Soy un...
¿Me escucha ahora sí?
Ahora perfecto.
Bueno, soy un joven mexicano, estoy trabajando con la caravana 43 de los padres de Ayotzinapa que desaparecieron a sus hijos. La caravana 43 llegó a los Estados Unidos este mes y estamos esperando que lleguen para que den sus demandas y platiquen con la comunidad mexicana. Estamos mostrando solidaridad con The Cuban Five y por eso estamos aquí, y nos alegra que estén contentas y queremos ver que los padres y madres de los normalistas tengan la misma oportunidad de ver a sus hijos de nuevo. Paz.
Sí. Nosotros también Estamos sintiendo mucho la situación de esa familia. Imaginamos lo que deben estar sufriendo y la solidaridad de nuestra familia y del pueblo de Cuba con el pueblo mexicano.
Sí. I'm a young Mexican man here who is representing the 43 Mexican students who are killed in Ayotzinapa in Mexico. There he's representing a caravan who's is now in the United States, reversing the U.S. and presenting a demand to the Mexican return their children alive. And we're waiting for the family to New York to present here. And we're here in solidarity with them, with the Cuban Five. I hope that the mothers of Ayotzinapa will also help the children again. And they said that they're also in solidarity with their struggle, and we're very happy to be here. And we're welcome home.
Bueno, yo sé que ya el tiempo ya se agotó, pero solamente quiere desde Nueva York, que le mandamos muchos saludos, muchos abrazos, muchos besos y gracias otra vez por compartir este gran evento. Y bueno, gracias por todo y por favor saludo a Tony por nuestra parte. Que gracias por su obra de artes que compartí con todo aquí, porque aquí es magnífico y de ahí, con nuestro corazón, bueno, solamente que puede ser hasta la vista, hasta la victoria siempre.
Bueno, mi mamá que les va a decir algo también de agradecimiento, ella está muy feliz porque siempre pensó que no llegaría el momento de poder ver a su hijo y ahora lo está disfrutando con mucha felicidad gracias al apoyo de todos ustedes. Ella les va a decir algo.
Aquí está respondiendo. Bueno, muchas gracias a todos por este momento tan especial para mí. Gracias. La traducción. ¿Sí? Gracias también por tener a Tony en representación de su pintura en ese lugar tan importante que fue la gran batalla de todos ustedes por el regreso de nuestros hijos.
Thank you very much for having this art exhibit and for fighting for his dreams.
Yo quisiera, en mi modesto inglés, aprendí tres palabras.
I learned three words in English.
Okay. Porque la traducción es buena, pero no lleva todo el sentimiento que uno dice.
Translation is very good, but it can't
por eso yo quiero decirle a ustedes, they are friends. Thank you very much. I love you, everybody. Thank you.
Bueno, muchas cosas buenas para ustedes también y ojalá encontremos a algunos amigos aquí el primero de mayo.
¡Viva Cuba!
¡Viva!
¡Viva el pueblo de Estados Unidos!
¡Viva!
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 Gracias.
and the food presentation. Thank you all for coming. And again, I want to passing a background for a quick donation, and we highly appreciate it. You know, that would be fantastic to, you know, to support the people. I want to thank again Dan Hendrick.
Thank you all for organizing. Thank you all for the members, and thank you all for coming. Very nice.
I just want to invite you all. I mean, San Juan is great. Havana reigns supreme. New York is the best town of all. Upstairs here on the Lower East Side of the Clemente, we have a great jazz concert, Arts for Arts. Some very professional jazzmen are putting a show up there. We also love art. So please, mill around, hang out, a beautiful thing. But make sure you take a quick glimpse upstairs and check out the scene. Please do. Thank you.
What I meant to say, and I do apologize for producing the exhibit, we're a little higher funds base, so we still need to raise about $200. So any donation tonight, we highly appreciate it. And thanks again, thank you all for coming. And I hope you enjoy the audience. Thank you.